Los hermanos Guy y Howard Lawrence acaban de lanzar Energy, su primer álbum en 5 años y el tercero en una carrera que parece más larga de lo que es. Provenientes de Surrey, Inglaterra, son reconocidos por haber revivido la cultura del garage británico, que floreció a comienzos de los 90 y de los que Goldie y Massive Attack son destacados exponentes. Su álbum Settle de 2010 los puso en el mapa de los especialistas y amantes de la música por igual, con un conjunto de canciones representativas de la cultura de clubes y también del emergente espíritu pop del comienzo de la década. Su continuación, Caracal, de 2015, volvió a ganarles miradas y alabanzas, pero también críticas y odios cuando exploraron en el mundo del R&B estadounidense junto al canadiense The Weeknd y la neozelandesa Lorde. Reunidos por primera vez en 4 meses desde el comienzo de la cuarentena global, Guy vive con su novia en Los Ángeles y Howard dedica sus tiempos libres al cultivo de vegetales orgánicos. Los Disclosure conversan sobre este nuevo álbum, sobre el espíritu colaborativo que ha conectado a los artistas por internet, sobre cómo este alimenta la curiosidad del nuevo oyente nacido en una velocidad distinta de consumo y sobre los 10 años de carrera condensados en 2 discos que han traspasado barreras generacionales, culturales y lingüísticas, con un poderoso sexto sentido que, unido a un virtuosismo muy nuevo, los hace famosos en estas épocas de disrupción y transformación. Ellos son Disclosure, mis invitados muy especiales a esta nueva edición de El Podcast por Canal 13.
How are you guys holding up? Where are you? Are you in the UK?
Yeah, we're in London now. It's only very recently that we've been able to see each other, but yeah, we're back.
Yeah, things are a little bit more normal at the moment in London. Like, stuff is open, people are outside, the weather is nice, so yeah, it feels good for now. Let's hope it stays that way. But yeah, I was in Los Angeles for about 3 months during the main lockdown, and Howard was here, so we didn't see each other for a long time. But yeah, now we're back together, which is cool.
What was it like to be in LA? Were you working on music over there?
No, I mean, my girlfriend is American, so I go there a lot anyway to see her, and we have a place there. Me and Howard do a lot of work in LA as well, but it just so happened that I was there and he was there, and then they stopped all the flights. So, you know, it just got stuck. But yeah, I passed the time with making music. I did a lot of DJ sets online as well, like for Boiler Room and, you know, various other things. Yeah, it was cool, man. It was a nice place to be whilst the whole lockdown thing was happening. And Howard was in the UK doing very different things to me. What were you doing, Howard?
Yeah, I spent most of the time planting trees and growing vegetables.
Yeah, fun.
Dedicated to the vegetable business?
Yeah, yeah. Maybe not the business, but to vegetables.
To vegetables worldwide.
Let's talk about the new songs. We've been playing all the new songs, which is crazy because when you're in the radio, you know, back like 20 years ago when I started on the radio, you would have one song by a particular artist or a main act, and you would, you know, beat that song to a pulp on the air. You know, you would play that song for over 6-7 months. But you guys just keep on pumping stuff out. It's like we don't know what to play, so we're just kind of like, you know, juggling all the music that you guys are putting out. Tell me about that process. Tell me about every single one of those songs, why you decide to push them out so quickly. You know, what goes through your mind with all this new material?
Well, I think, thank you for playing them. That's awesome. And I like the album behind you. That's looking very nice. Yeah, I think we took a lot of time off where we didn't release anything as Disclosure. So, you know, we built up a lot of material over that time. We did a few projects for other people, such as Mac Miller, Chloe and Halle, Aminé. So, you know, there were bits and pieces, and we did drop an EP here and there. But yeah, I don't know. I think we wanted to make sure we had a lot of material ready to go bang, bang, bang with, just because times move quickly now, man. You know, the way that people consume music has changed, you know, with the rise of things like Spotify and Apple Music. And, you know, people want a lot of content fast. And so we were like, okay, well, if you give us a few years, we'll give you a load of content when we're ready. So, yeah, that's, I think we had to move with the times to some extent. But yeah, I don't know. It wasn't too planned to just be one after the other. It was more like we wanted to build a whole album. We knew that. We knew we wanted to write a third album and not just do singles or EPs. And yeah, in order to do that, we decided this time that we were going to write a huge chunk of songs and cut it down. That's not how we've done it before. We used to just kind of write 20 songs and then be left with 15. But this time we wrote 200 and we had to choose 11. So yeah, very different process, a lot of sacrifice and a lot of stuff thrown in the bin. But you know, that for us was a difficult but worthwhile process, because what we're left with are the songs that we just absolutely love and couldn't do without. And we, you know, we worked hard on them, but they were also really enjoyable to make. You know, we were able to try and branch out into different genres that we've never touched on before. Like, there are two songs on this album that aren't even in English, you know, so that's new for us. Loads of different genres on there, African artists, South American influence as well, like on tracks like Energy, you know, big Brazilian drums on there. Rappers, working with rap artists on our album is the first for us too. So, you know, it was like, there were so many things we wanted to do, we just needed time to do it. So yeah, it took us about 2 or 3 years to write the album. But yeah.
Tell me about working with Mac Miller.
Yeah, so that was just me, actually. I was in LA and Mac was there. And yeah, we just decided to get together and make a song. Simple as that. Yeah, I think we did 2 days. Yeah, it was definitely, most of it was done in 1 day, though. I played him 3 or 4 beats that I'd been messing with. And Blue World was one of those. And he just immediately was like, I love that one. And he started rapping into his phone straight away and coming up with the lyrics. And that track kind of was just sitting around on my laptop for a long time. And then sadly, you know, he passed away, which is a, you know, a tragedy and a conversation for another day. But yeah, his family and his team got in touch with us about 6-7 months ago, and they told us they were putting together a posthumous album of his material that hadn't come out yet, and they wanted Blue World to be a part of that project. So, you know, it was nice that it came from the family and his team. You know, I would never have wanted to put that song out had it not come from that side. So yeah, it was nice that it saw the light of day, because I was really proud of that song, and I think it's great. So yeah, it's nice that it's out there now.
On the hip hop side, am I getting this wrong, or are you working with Slo Ty on a song?
Well, he's on the record, so there's that. But yeah, I mean, I've done a couple of days with his producer making beats. Have we done another day with Ty?
No, we just done one day.
Yeah, he's just on My High. He's just on that song. So yeah, Slo Ty is awesome. Yeah, love him.
Yeah, that one's high octane disclosure energy going on, man.
Energy, exactly.
We wrote that song with Amine, like the whole thing we wrote with Amine, and then we spoke about it with Amine about the fact that like it would be cool to have someone else on the second verse, and it was already such a high energy tune, as you say, and we were like, well, there's only one guy who's going to be able to up that level of energy, you know. It had to be Ty for sure.
Why is this the first time you guys work on with hip-hop collaborators? Why hadn't it popped up before?
I mean, we have worked with them, just not on our own stuff. But generally speaking, like, you know, with our first album, like, we were just kids from Surrey in the UK, and like, there aren't many rappers there. You know, we didn't know many rappers. We listened to a lot. Like, we've always listened to loads of hip hop, especially like J Dilla and that style. And that's hence, you know, we worked with Common. But like, I think the main reason we've chosen to do it is because we have the opportunity to.
Yeah. Now, making music for 10 years is like playing a computer game, and you move up the levels and you unlock new people that you can join and play the game with. You know, you get to level, well, what are we on, level 10, year 10,
yeah,
you've unlocked Common, you've unlocked Khalees. You know, when you start out, you're never going to get hold of those guys. You know, you have to put in some work to get to them. Yeah. So
one day we'll just unlock Stevie Wonder.
Yeah, that's Stevie Wonder's the ultimate boss. Yeah, he's at the top. Yeah,
boss level.
Oh man, that I'm looking forward to that level getting unlocked before my time, man. I mean, like, that would be definitely awesome, especially because, you know, I enjoyed so much what you guys did on Caracol with the entire R&B spectrum, with, you know, unlocking that American R&B level, even though you also had some, I think you had some international, you had Lord on it and the whole thing, but it sounded so grounded in R&B and soul, and it was so satisfying to play that on the radio as well, you know.
Awesome. Thank you. Thanks, man. Yeah, that was definitely a big influence for that record, was the R&B side of things. You know, we've grown up listening to a lot of it. We were listening to a lot of it at the time. And yeah, like having The Weeknd on the record, yeah, unlocked The Weeknd.
Yeah, and Nocturnal was one of those songs that was like, it was such a pleasure to play on the radio, even though radio, you know, mainstream radio doesn't actually play those things anymore. But as a radio personality who also tries to curate what's best for an audience that tends to be smaller for this particular type of music, it was definitely a thrill to get that song on the air, you know. And you know, getting back to playing you guys on the radio right now, I'd like to talk about that collaboration on Ultimatum. I think you got Fatoumata Diawara. Is that her name?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
That's a pretty cool song. Tell me a little bit about it, because that was like the very first thing that popped up in our radar once you guys came back on the scene, and it was like, oh, let's go with this one, because it's, you know, really dancey, it's groovy, but then it's got this African feel to it, which makes it foreign and strange, but at the same time exciting.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, hey, thank you for all the support. That's really awesome that you've been playing those songs. Yeah. I think Nocturnal is like 7 minutes long, so that's probably why it doesn't get played on radio very much. But yeah, Ultimatum. So that song came around. I think we were looking through samples and looking through, you know, just different genres of music. And we came across one of her albums or an album that she was featured on or something like that. And yeah, decided to start chopping and sampling. And the original version of Ultimatum was just, you know, a single file, which was her song. And kind of sounded a bit more lo-fi, and you know, it was the best mix we could make from it, and we sent it over to her team for approval, and she liked it so much that she was like, do you want to have all the stems and all the parts to the song so you can make it sound better and you can mess with my voice a bit more? And so then it took on a whole new life, and that's how the relationship started, because you know, we knew she was a fan at that point. And so yeah, that was Ultimatum, and now we come to this album, and she's on track 5, Marley Marley.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so that, you know, same kind of thing. That's one of her older songs. She sent over a load of stems after Ultimatum, being, you know, she loved it so much. She was like, just have all of it. Like, take my voice, see what you can do. And that's what happened with Marley Marley. It was just another experiment. You know, different feel to the song, a little bit more upbeat, a little bit more garagey, perhaps. Ultimatum's a little bit more of a deep housey roller. But yeah, you know, same thing. And I think we just love the sound of her voice on our stuff. I think it works really well with, you know, our general sound and the vibe. And yeah, man, she's very kind to let us mess with her voice and take it into a different genre. We were just speaking to her on the phone the other day, and she was saying how much she sings a lot about very serious subjects, but she always tries to frame it with happy, uplifting, danceable music. So I think when she hears her voice on our stuff, she's, you know, really even more happy about that, because she's, you know, she's very into dancing your problems away, is what she said. So yeah, it's been fun working with her.
What drives you towards a collaboration in this case, and what makes, or how do you decide to go this route? Because like I said before, Caracol had this rhythmical, really sometimes radio friendly, sometimes just, you know, really groovy side to it, and then you get to this new material and there's exciting new stuff from, you know, lots of people whom we may not know of yet, like Fatoumata, like Slow Tie, because I know Slow Tie is huge in the UK right now, but it's like, if you start talking about Slow Tie here, it's going to take us a while to get people used to that. So what's the process of picking those collaborators in this case, and how does it differ from Caracol?
I'd say the process of picking them doesn't really differ from Caracol. It's just we've got a different result this time. But the process is generally like, we just ask anyone that we're fans of if they want to make some music. And yeah, if they say yes, then we'll make some music.
Yeah, the number one thing is we're just fans. The same as anyone is a fan of anyone. It's just that we're lucky enough that when we tell them we're fans of you, do you want to work? They say yeah. That's the number one thing, though, man, that we never go into a room with someone just because they're big or just because they're already well established. None of that matters. We have to be a fan of the music first, number one. That's the most important.
And okay, you know, and usually it's that, you know, usually we're already really big fans of their work, but occasionally like our managers or label or someone, a friend will say like, oh, you should check this person out. and we'll listen to like two or three of their songs, and if we're feeling it, we'll maybe hit them up as well. You know, like we're not like only hitting up people we know very well. Like the Fatimata tune that you mentioned, like Ultimatum, like that was the first thing we'd heard of hers, and we just thought it was so dope that we wanted to make an edit or something.
And I think Channel Trez is a good example. Like I knew one Channel song, and he's very new and upcoming, and you know, the next week we're in the room with him.
So but then the contrast to that, you know, is like people like Khalees and Common that we've been fans of for 20 years, and
it's nice to strike a balance. I don't know, I think people do look to us to find new artists as well. You know, they know that we'll work with legendary artists and also new guys as well. So I think it's not a responsibility for us to do that, but it's like a nice bonus if we can unlock someone new and find a new talent that, you know, that hasn't, is just coming up, like you said, Slow Tie, or Channel Trez for me is like, I'm so excited about Channel Trez at the moment. Everything he's releasing has been brilliant, and I'm excited to see what he does, and it's nice to have him on the album.
And I'm very excited to hear what's coming up tonight and what's coming up next. When's the album coming up?
It's actually out in a month.
Thank you very much for taking the time, guys. It's been great talking to you and meeting you virtually. You know, it's very exciting to get the chance. I was going to brag about my Caracol album, but I couldn't find it. So,
but thanks, Alejandro. We really appreciate the support. And we hope we can make it back over there very soon.
We look forward to seeing you guys. You know, I saw you play in Lollapalooza in Chicago like 4 years ago, 5 years ago. Man, that was surreal. that experience of seeing you guys perform at that place, you know, which is like such a mecca of electronic music, and you getting there, that was amazing. I just wanted to say that before leaving, you know.
Thanks, man. No, that was one of our all-time favorites too. Like you said, legendary town, massive festival. Yeah, it was a great day. Really enjoyed that one.